Hello, my fellow parasites.
Parasites? Apologize!
No. Anyway, welcome to Season 4 of the Venom Vlog. This season we'll be covering Venom 2 movie news, more classic Venom and Carnage stories, the Spider-Man Maximum Venom animated series, and all comics involving Eugene Flash Thompson. So sit back and enjoy another exciting episode of the Venom Vlog.
I'm Tom Hardy and you're watching the Venom Vlog. Oh, man.
Hey everybody, welcome back to another Venom vlog, and today we're going to talk about the Wrapped shooting for the Venom 2 movie. If you go over to IMDb, you're actually going to see that they listed the movie now as being in post-production. And back when the movie, before it started filming, or right around the time it started filming, we did a video about pre-production. What was pre-production? So I thought we would do something similar to that here with post-production, because I know there's a lot of questions people ask, like, what's the process of filmmaking? And that's one of the things that I tried to shine some light on. I am not an expert. Most of the stuff I get, you know, is from the internet. I'm like looking up, you know, the steps of post-production, things like that. So I'll link anything that I'm referencing here. I'll put in the description box below so you can go check and see, you know, in case we skip a step or miss something. It's the best way to, you know, just check for yourself and kind of see all this information, because there's a ton of it here. You know, post-production is not an easy process of the filmmaking. It's actually probably one of the most difficult. Obviously, there's a lot of challenges in each step. Pre-production is mainly just people who plan stuff, who, you know, are good at scheduling and things like that. And they come together and they work out little things and try to make everything ready for the shooting days so that those are, you know, go by, you know, easier and smoother. And it sounds like it has. Like, it sounds like this movie had a really good pre-production and filming process from what I heard. And they even realized a couple things they needed for pickup shots and reshoots, and they already did them. Like, they squeezed them in the last week of while they're in San Francisco, apparently. So that's a good sign. That means they're already, you know, one step ahead of the game. And they've already got, you know, Andy Serkis already has kind of his vision in a way of like what he needs and stuff. And obviously there may still be things in, you know, that they discover in post-production where he goes, you know what, we don't have this, or we need this. And that'll help explain this better. That happens with every movie. So that's why every movie needs reshoots and you know, pickup shots and stuff like that. So that could still happen. But what we're going to do here today, and now that we know that the filming has wrapped, because I heard that they were probably going to go to the last day of February, but I was trying to keep an ear out to hear anything definitive. And I know a lot of you guys out there asked me like, hey, what's the shooting schedule? What's this? What's that? And it's like, oh, look, I can tell you what I heard, and I still won't, though, in case it's wrong. But I also, like, some things I don't want to give away. Obviously, that information gets out there, too. So, like, people, if you just follow, you know, if you just watch on Instagram, you can follow the hashtags. Like, that's why I mentioned it in earlier episodes. I'm like, all right, if I mention that you can just search for hashtags and stuff and Venom 2 on Twitter, you'll see where they're filming, you know, if you're in that area where they're filming. And that's why I kept referencing that, because I'm like, all right, maybe that's enough of a breadcrumb that people who really want to go to the set will go check it out. But yeah, I had some people going like, dude, I'm just catching up on your episodes and I live in San Francisco and where are they filming now? And it's like, I'm sorry. And it looks like the filming's over. So I apologize that, you know, you weren't around and saw my posts. I apologize. But I try to get that information in some form out there, or at least give you the means to go look for it yourself. Yeah, so the filming, I think it went up till maybe the last day of February. I think we saw a guy on the 28th or 29th posting a picture with Tom Hardy in San Francisco. So it looks like maybe they ran all the way up to the end of the month, which I kind of figured they would. And we also heard from, I think there was like a news reporter in San Francisco that we talked about in a previous episode, and she mentioned that they were filming till the end of the month. So it looks like that was all accurate information. It turned out to be accurate information. And now that the filming is wrapped, they go into post-production. And that's what basically where they edit the film together and they bring all the elements that were filmed all in one place and start creating the vision of the film, right? And so like when they say you make a film, they say you make it three times. It's kind of a saying out here in Hollywood where they go, all right, you make the film in pre-production. That's like one version of the film. So it's like the script and all the planning and everything. And then when you're filming, you're going to add stuff. The actors are going to bring things. They're going to bring a different energy to it. They're going to do different takes. And you're going to get all that footage. And then, so that's like the second time you make the film. And then the final time you make the film is here in post-production. But you do make the film a couple times in post-production also. There's like an assembly cut. And then there's like a director's cut, if you will. And then there's the final version. And so we're going to kind of go through some of that here today. And I got a couple different links. I have Wikipedia up just for some things. But I have this Indie Film Hustle link that I'm going to put in the description box below. Blow. This is more for indie filmmaking, but it does talk about a lot of the steps that you would go through in, you know, making a blockbuster film as well. So I thought that was good information. Then we also have something from wolfcrow.com. It's like an overview of the different stages of post-production. So we'll talk a little bit about that. And then I have a couple little other, you know, sites that are just brought up to kind of help us, you know, understand some of the process. And the main processing is for post-production is it's video editing. So you want to make sure that's what you're doing, is the editing together a cut of the movie. But there's going to be writing involved in some degree. There's going to be re-recording as well, and then editing the soundtrack. You got to get that in there. You're going to do things with a Foley, which is like a sound effect people that come in. There's ADR that we're going to talk about all that today. There's visual effects. There's sound design. There's so much stuff. Color correction. You know, there's so much. And the funny thing is when people think post-production, they go, okay, so the pre-production people are working. That means the people doing the production, the filming, they're not working. That's not true at all. When pre-production starts, a lot of the people in production also start, especially Andy Serkis and his close team. People are already talking to Tom. He's already working out beats for stuff. Stunts, you know, they're already rehearsing stunts and everything. And those people are going to be on the set when they're filming. So, so guys like Jake and stuff. So it's like, yeah, the filming process is crazy, and it never stops, really. Once they green light the movie, people start working on it. And then once they officially go into pre-production, there's a lot of production people that are already being hired that are going to go do tech scouts and all that. We talked about that previously on that episode. And so I'll put a link to that episode down below if you want to see more about what pre-production is. And I'm not going to make a video on what production is, because we kind of covered a lot of it when we were talking about these videos that leaked out from the sets. And when I went and visited the set, we kind of talked about and shown, you know, a lot of the work that goes into filming the movie. So we won't do a video on that. But this, you know, we have, you know, post-production, now that it started, or it has already started. So like pre-production, production people were working. Once production went into effect, post-production started. So yeah, the next phase already started. So they've already been looking at dailies, and that's kind of the process we can talk about here. It's like when they finish filming, you kind of have the director going and looking at dailies with the editor. Usually they ask their DP, like, hey, you know, could you recommend a good editor, someone you've worked with before, or maybe Andy's worked with somebody before that he really likes. And so they kind of put that information together. They go and, you know, hire an editor. That editor will, you know, and those production people will hire the rest of the team, an assistant editor, anyone else that needs to, like, you know, run tapes or, you know, digitize stuff or whatever. And depending on what they're filming with and stuff. So there's a lot of, again, there's a big process there. But early on, right when they start filming, those dailies, the stuff they shoot each day, whether it's photography stuff or video, obviously, all that will get sent, though it'll get delivered to the post-production place, and those people will start working on it. The editor will start working on it and start making essentially what is an assembly cut. What you'll have there, it's like 50% visuals, 50% audio. Again, I'm getting this information from Wolf Crow. And I've worked in production, I've worked in pre-production and post-production, but I've never seen the whole picture. And that's what some of this information here is. So this is me learning too and sharing with you guys what I'm learning. But also, you know, just know that I can maybe get some stuff wrong or interpret things wrong. And if I do, that's why I urge you to go check out these links yourself and kind of check out, you know, the processes and everything. So the assembly stage is like, you know, they take the principal photography, the stuff they filmed, any second unit stuff that they've shot, any reshoot stuff that they were able to pick up. In this case, they might have done last week. And then any production stills. And they take all of that and they start making their assembly cut. And then they start realizing as they put that together, what they don't have. We need a pickup shot of this. We need, you know, there's a glass that breaks in the background. It'd be really cool to show that glass hit the ground. Maybe we can get someone to go and just film a bottle hitting the ground. Or, you know what, it'd be really great if Tom could say this in the scene. That's where you bring in like ADR maybe, unless you're like, we need a close-up of it. Okay, then we got to go get Tom back. We got to match his hair the best we can. You've seen some movies not do that well and other movies do. So it looks like they already try to do some of these pickups already, which is good. That means the editor already has kind of this vision of what he's cutting together. The assembly cut is in some ways an editor's cut. And so he's, you know, or he or she is putting all this together and like, okay, we could use a couple pickups here. And it sounds like that information already went to the set and Andy and them already got those, some of those shots. So sounds like a smooth process, right? Like it's a machine for sure. So to have it run as a well-oiled machine is tricky sometimes. So it sounds like the communication, and that's key, is communication between departments. It sounds like it it's going as smooth as possible. Of course, there's probably hiccups and bumps in the road, but it sounds so far that everything on Venom 2 is going along swimmingly, which is great. They also realized without pickups, they might need some CGI shots, you know, visual effects, some keying things going on, and stock footage. They might need some stock footage of, you know, aerial shots of San Francisco or whatever, or like the carnival. We talked about the Carnival of the Damned or whatever. Maybe they need, if that's in the movie, maybe they need like a big wide shot of that. But that's got to be filmed on the day. Stock footage is more like, hey, well, you know, we didn't get a really good aerial shot of San Francisco, or we just need cutaways for quick cuts of people just walking in San Francisco, and we didn't shoot enough of that. Okay, and then they go to a stock footage archive and they buy that footage, and they go, okay, this movie shot a bunch of stuff downtown, or this production company just went and shot a bunch of B-roll, and you can buy it from us, and it's you know, matches your quality of your film. And then you can, you know, color correct it and match it to your film if you need to. So that's where stock footage comes in. It's just, you know, this extra footage out there of just things happening in the city or wherever they need it, in the woods, wherever they need it. So yeah, so that's the assembly stage, is putting all that stuff together, realizing what you need, and then going through, and you got the location sound. So you want to sync the sound up with that. Again, pickups, if you need to get pickups with audio. You got ADR. Which is, you know, you're adding into the, you know, you're adding in more additional audio, basically. It's a automatic dialogue replacement. And this is a step carried out in a big room with projectors, where they basically, and you've probably seen it in certain shows, like if you watch Entourage, they showed it a lot in that too, where there's a, you know, you're essentially in a little movie theater, there's a big projection screen, and the actor is watching themselves on screen, and they're trying to say the new words that need to be said and match their lips, because maybe they filmed it on that day, but the audio, there was like an issue with it, or it didn't come out as clean, or they had to add in these other effects, and they can't like match the, they can't make the audio stand out above the rain or whatever. So you got to like come in, you know, and re-record. Sometimes that happens. And so that's what ADR is. And we saw like a Chope Aluko, who was in the first Venom movie, she came in and did an ADR scene at some point, like she did some ADR recording. And we saw all that, you know, in the first Venom movie. So that's kind of the process there. But then also in the audio process, there's Foley artists. And Foley artists are the people who make the sounds of the dialogue clear, or when the sound is, the dialogue is not clear in the end. In the editing process, you have to go in again and do ADR. But what these guys do is like, okay, the audio sounds great, but while that person's talking, a bottle smashes in the background, and we don't have a clear sound of that now. So someone now, instead of the actor going into the audio room and recording ADR, this Foley artist will go in, and they'll come in with a bottle, and they'll put it right, you know, they'll get the microphone ready, and they'll smash the bottle right next to the microphone, and then boom, they got the sound effect for the bottle smashing. Sometimes footprints, when people are walking in the woods, their feet aren't mic'd, you know. They might have a boom mic above them to hit, catch any dialogue, or maybe they're, you know, they have a lav on them to catch any dialogue. But mostly it's a boom mic, most likely, because you don't want to see that lav in the movie. So you'll have that boom mic. It's not catching their footsteps. And you kind of need, I don't know, it's just a typical movie thing where it's like, yeah, mostly in real life when you're walking around, you might not hear your footsteps. But in movies, they need to add that stuff in. It just kind of adds to the scene. So there's like a million sounds going on in a lot of scenes. That's why when movies make really quiet scenes, it's so effective, especially if they do it really well, is because you're so used to sound in film. And so that's what, you know, the Foley artists will do. They'll come in and they'll, you know, crunch things on wood, you know, or like they'll get some gravel and they'll put a shoe or whatever, and they'll try to mimic the sound of footprints walking, and they'll record it and stuff. And it's pretty fun. It's a neat process. It's a weird thing to watch, because sometimes Foley artists get really creative and they're like, oh, we need something that sounds like, you know, a boot stuck in mud or something. So then they won't go get mud in a boot usually. They'll go get something that they're like, oh, in this, I did that before in something else. So they'll go get like some kind of something else, you know, something that's easy to get at like a store, like a store-bought thing. And then they'll grab it and they'll come in and they'll make the sound and they'll be like, yeah, that sounds like a boot, you know, stuck in mud or whatever. So yeah, it's pretty neat to kind of see a Foley artist at work, because it's very creative. Video game Foley artists are sound designers and stuff are amazing. I watched a lot of behind the scenes on video game making, and the stuff that come up with sound effects like swords clashing and all this stuff it's fantastic. It's so cool. And then also the electronic part of the studio sound, and then recording music. That's also in there too. So we'll go through kind of the stages here. We have like when the post-production starts, you want to obviously get your editor, and you want to select kind of your editing software. So whatever that editor's used to working with, like Avid or Final Cut or whatever, they're going to figure out what kind of format or software that they want to use that they are very familiar with, and they know will give them the tools to do what they need to do with this certain project. And some editors are fluid in multiple softwares just because, you know, they're like, hey, this software will provide this that this one doesn't, and so on and so forth. Or I know how to use this one easier when it comes to doing this kind of stuff. And so I want to make my job less intense. So if I have to fix something last minute, I know I can do it easier in this software. So there's a lot of consideration that goes into there. Then there's the selection of creative picture editor. So obviously we talked about finding yourself a good editor. And then there's the selection of sound editor. So again, going through the stages, hiring the right people, getting everyone in the position they need to be in. So that way this process can move along really, really smoothly. There's a lot of tools that editors can use, and I'm getting this information from Premium Beat. They kind of list it as an arsenal for editors about different cuts of the movie. There's standard cut, where it's just like just cut the frame, and sometimes you'll see that in YouTube videos, just regular cuts. Jump cuts are another one where you get to, it's kind of stuttering the shot of it, if you will. There's a J cut, there's the L cut, cutting on action, cross cutting, cutaways, montage, match cut. There's different styles and things they have to bring. So I'll put a link to that down below so you can kind of go through and read about each like different style of cutting, like when you're editing and stuff. And this is cool too, because me as someone who edits his own YouTube videos, and I'm trying to learn as well. I'm trying to learn techniques and get better at it if I can. But I think also getting better at editing is getting better at shooting. So when I get to a point where I don't just have a static camera filming me, I mean, that works for the Venom vlog, but there's other videos I try to make where I go down out into the world and I try different filming styles, and that helps me editing wise. So I might do like pan shots, but then I might do a static shot, because when I'm editing, I want the option of, which one I'm going to use and what fits, any music I put in and stuff like that. So you kind of do have to have a vision, or have to think about things you may need when you're filming stuff. But the 13 steps of post-production from raindance.org, you have your, pick an editing format or software, hire your editor, hire your sound editor, do ADR, which we talked about already, do Foley, which we also talked about, secure music. So making sure your musical score is there, and any music you're going to use, from Eminem, if he's going to record a song for you or whatever, you want to start locking that stuff down, start getting that stuff in the process and working if it hasn't already started. Then doing re-recording and then doing the mix. So that's when you have about 20 to 40 tracks of sound or dialogue, ADR, Foley, music, all that stuff. And you got to layer them on top of each other to actually create a feeling of sound with depth. That is called re-recording session, or the mix is what it's also known as. Get an M&E. Somewhere in the not too distant future, you'll be selling the rights to your film to foreign nations. This is not something that probably Venom has to go through too much, but it's the M&E stands for music and effects. So in the movie that this person just made, they waited for, they had a sale where they demanded an M&E track. In their case, it was Germany, and they used part of the proceeds to pay for it. So I guess they funded their movie and they used some of that money to pay for the M&E. And I know for the music and effects, of course, anything that, has to be paid for, Venom 2 will pay for it. But I feel like this is more indie filmmaking too, from some of these articles that I'm reading. So you apply it a little differently. So what they might have to go through might be a tougher process for them, but an easier process for something like Venom 2 that has millions of dollars to throw at problems. Get your title, now that your editing is done, what is left to get the final pieces needed for the answer print. The first three pieces to get are your 6 to 8 opening title cards, and then the rear title crawl. These title files are then added to the master track. So working on your opening credit sequence, and then also the end credit sequence. Sometimes, I think in Venom 1, they just kind of did the titles over shot film. So that could be the case sometimes. I think Justice League might have done that too, and a couple other movies. But then sometimes you get something like Birds of Prey, where they do a big animated opening and they do the credits that way. Or Deadpool, for example, did that as well. So yeah, there's different types of titles you can make. You can either make one of your own and create it fully in post, or you can do something, that is, they just take footage that's shot for the movie because they're like, hey, we want to get into the story. Let's keep going. Let's not waste with a 1 minute intro. Let's get right into it. So there's different options in telling your story. Getting a DCP, which is a digital cinema package, a hard drive which contains the final copy of your film. Again, some of this is more for indie filmmaking and stuff. But after that, something that happens in a lot of movies is you got to get a dialogue script. And a dialogue script is for foreign territories. So I've done dialogue scripts before, actually. I just realized this when I was reading this. I was like, Hey, I've done that job actually for like 6 months, not too long ago. It was like a some like YouTube like web guru guy. A friend of mine named Alex hooked me up with this lady who was working for him, and she's like, "Hey, we need some dialogue scripts." And at the time, I was like, "I don't know what that is actually." So I researched it a little bit, but then I was like, "All right, I'll take the job," you know. And basically, what they do is they send you a video, and you're kind of watching the video and listening to what the person's saying, and you're writing a script, basically just repeating what they said, and that way you have, and then you put the time code in. All right, at this from this time, this is what they say. And that helps for foreign territories to put subtitles in their movies, and that's what we were doing. I was doing these dialogue scripts, and those were being turned into subtitles for this person's YouTube channel. So yeah, it's pretty neat, and also like videos on their website too. So yeah, that's a process that you got to get through. So they will hire someone to come in and write, you know, those kind of things and write those scripts, and just basically you're just watching the movie, you know, like you're watching each scene like 10 times or however many times you need to, you know, to get the time code and to write the dialogue down, and then you move on to the next scene and stuff like that. So yeah, and I don't think one person does the whole movie. I think maybe they just hire a couple people and they each pick scenes, you know, because they want to get it done in a timely manner, and they want to be able to double check the work. So it's easier to not put all that on one person's shoulder, because by the end of the movie, that person will very, very be very tired for sure. Then after that, you want to get a campaign image. You want to put out an official image or a poster or something out there to promote the movie. And then obviously you want to get a trailer going for 90 second, 90 to 120 seconds typically is what a trailer will go for, with, you know, some variation, of course. So that, yeah, it's not until step 13 that they get into the trailer process. But remember, a lot of these steps have already been done for Venom, even though they just entered the post-production phase. So even though it's like, you know, they probably already started working on titles, they probably already got their digital cinema packet. Well, probably not that far yet, but they're probably already working on certain scenes once they lock them. Assembly cut is, like I said, that's where the editor, that's like an editor's cut. So when we watched, I think on episode 100, Spider-Man 3, the editor's cut, that's kind of, I guess, the assembly cut, or that's what they're marketing it as. I'm sure it's not the exact assembly cut, because there would probably be a lot more footage in the movie. But after the assembly cut, then you're going to go on to, you know, the mixing stage, the mastering stage. So again, in mixing stage, you're going to do editing, compositing, motion graphics, color grading. So that's where all that comes in. Sound editing, music mixing, and sound mixing. There's a ton of stuff that goes into that. The color grading, obviously, so you get your tone, your vision. Because when you shoot something and it looks good on camera, you might get into the editing room and go, "This looks good, but from this cut to this cut to this cut, there's an inconsistency visually, and you don't want to jar the audience. So you're going to color correct things to make them all look like one cohesive thing." So again, a lot of work goes into filmmaking. The mastering stage is rendering the final master of the movie. So we're past the, you know, or not the final master, but well, I guess the final master, but you're past the assembly stage, and now you're getting into what might be known as the director's cut. And the director's cut is kind of what, you know, Andy Serkis, now that he's done filming, he'll be in the editing room with the editor going, "All right, let's here's I now I'm watching your cut, and here's more footage we're adding to it. Let's go scene by scene, and let's try to figure this out, and let's make it more attuned to my vision of it. Now that you've put all the pieces in place, now let me communicate with you, and we can work together and kind of fine tune it." So it's almost like tuning a piano. It's like, all right, you know, the editor assembled the piano, but now it needs some tuning. And that's where Andy Serkis will come in and be like, "All right, here's how we tune it to make a sound that I want." You know, and then after he makes his cut or the director's cut, and so this is for all those people out there, you know, screaming for the Zack Snyder cut. You know, if he has a cut of the movie, that's where this phase ends. So there's Andy Serkis will have his cut, you know, Snyder had his cut, you know, before their movies came out. And that's when then that cut might get shown to some people. They might do a special screening, either in-house, or maybe they'll bring in a few, you know, outside people like fans, or, you know, they'll make them sign, you know, non-disclosure agreements. And they'll be like, "You can come into the studio, you can watch this. We're only going to let like 50 people in, 100 people in, and we want to get a focus group going, and we want to hear what your feedback is on this movie, and if there's anything from just a viewer's viewpoint that we need to fix or that you think wasn't clear." That could sometimes happen with this director's cut. And then from there, they give all those notes to the studio, and you get like a producer or two. I think in Venom 1's case, it was Tom Rothman. I heard that might have come in, who's the head of Sony, and he came in and helped in the final editing process. That's what I heard anyway. So I don't know if that's true. That sounds like an intense thing for him to do, but at the same time, he wanted to make sure that movie was a hit. So he, you know, he could did what he could. And I know a lot of people, you know, don't like Tom Rothman because he like passed on Sonic and Deadpool when he, when he worked at Fox, and those went off to become like, big, movies and make a lot of money so far with Sonic. So even though it hasn't released in China or Japan yet, it's still doing pretty well. So yeah, I know some people kind of rail against them, but if you watch the Spider-Verse commentary, Phil Lord and Chris Miller, they actually say a lot of great things about Tom Rothman. They're like, yeah, he came in with us when we were editing in certain parts, and this was his idea, and this was his idea, and they kind of say like he helped push them in directions that, they thought made the film better. So just because someone's a business person or a suit at a company doesn't mean they only interject badly, I mean that's never the case where it's 100% bad advice, but yes, do some people make mistakes and pass on things that are hits, or turn out to be hits? Yes, and that's the risk of the business sometimes. So with Rothman, I heard he might have come in and acting as head of Sony, came in and tweaked things for the final edit. And we heard that Tom, Hardy was like, oh, there's a lot of stuff on the cutting room floor, like maybe 40 minutes of stuff that of like him being, eccentric and everything. Or he's like, yeah, there was some stuff in the movie that was really good that we cut, and it just never made any of the final cuts or whatever. And so it's like, yeah, that happens. But in this case, so after Andy finishes his cut of the film, the director's cut, it'll then go on to an editor or a producer. So maybe they'll pick Matt Tolmach, or they'll pick that Hutch guy or whatever, Parker Hutch or whatever his name is. They'll pick somebody who like is close to the production, who's worked on it, and maybe even Tom Rothman again, and they'll bring them in, and they'll work with editors to fine tune it according to the notes they got. Then they'll also interject their own personal, vision of it, and they'll kind of tweak it again and again, fine tuning the piano. But now that Andy fine tuned it to a sound that he finds enjoyable, these guys will come in and fine tune it to a sound that they think will be more acceptable to a bigger audience. Because obviously the goal here is to make money. So they want to do the best they can to make it feel more mainstream, I guess. And that's kind of all the process. And then the last stage is kind of creating the deliverables. So you'll kind of have the theatrical DCP or equivalent version of it, theatrical mix, which is Dolby, DTS, THX, etc., television HD cam, SR, television stereo. So you're cutting together like trailers, snippets, what are those called? Like where they're like a little like 10 to 20 second TV spots. That's what it is, TV spots. You'll cut together stuff like that. You'll work on the Blu-ray. You'll work on the DVD. You'll probably start recording the audio commentary at some point around this time. The soundtrack, you're starting to package that, getting the songs locked in and starting to mass produce those, bonus features, marketing packages, trailers, all that stuff, stuff for the internet, because you got to make different versions of it based on different things. So like some internet places that you're going to air it, you're going to be like, oh, this is going to not show in 4K on this website. So we got to make a version that's lower res, but still looks good for that website. Whereas, okay, now we're going to do the 4K version for over here. So much, right? So yeah, our first video when we talked about pre-production was about half hour long, and that's about this one too. Post-production is a beast, and it's a lot of working, it's a lot of gears in the machine working together, and that's why I love movies. Like I think it's so interesting. There's so many people online that talk about movies and cover movie news, but they never once take time to like talk about the making of a movie, what goes into making a movie, how stressful it can be, the stages of it, the process of it. It's a beast, and it's good, always good to educate people and yourself on stuff. Like, yeah, okay, you don't know how movies are made? Well, do some research. I just Googled, the steps of post-production, and all these websites came up, and I'm like, yeah, this is great, because I've worked in post-production for years, but on reality TV shows and a couple scripted shows, and so I know what my small part was in each of those, but I don't know everything that goes on, and this gave me a good window in that. I should have known. If I was better at my job at that point, I would have known everything that gone on, because I would have tried to learn and grow and move up in post-production, but I wasn't very good at a lot of this stuff, and so I never really took the dive, and it wasn't until I started creating a YouTube show that I started really getting interested in editing, and I was like, dang, I worked in post-production for years, and I could have taken an interest in, and I didn't. I don't know why. It's definitely a regret. It's me kicking myself in the nuts for sure on that one, but this is neat. All this stuff is cool. I'm going to put links to all this down below, the Wolf Crow website, the Indie Hustle one, the Rain Dance one, Premium Beat. I think we talked a little bit about their site, and then I'll put the link to the Wikipedia on film editing and the history of film editing and stuff. We didn't really cover too much of that, but I put it down there. They kind of talk about how early days, they just did like a lock-off shot, almost like a Kevin Smith early movie, like Clerks, where they just put the camera on sticks or a tripod, and they just try to do it all in one, you know, and that way it's less editing, less, you know, you have to do later on, because back then they didn't really have the tools to do this. But once they started getting into editing and, you know, cutting film and splicing stuff together like that, that was like an original way of doing it. And then it got easier with the, you know, bringing enough computers and stuff. So, yeah, they kind of go over some of that in there. So I'll put a link to that down below too. But let me know what you think. So this is what they're doing from now on. I think one of these sites lists like how many weeks it might be for like certain things. So like if you have, you know, a certain cut of something, I think they mentioned that, you know, you'll wait. Oh, yeah. After hiring a sound editor. So about 2 months later, the picture film is tight, but you need to enhance the look with sound, thus hiring a sound editor. So the sound editor's probably already been hired at this point. The normal schedule for editing a feature is somewhere between 8 to 10 weeks. But again, they've already started. So they've already been working on it. So that an assembly cut, you know, once all the footage gets brought in, now that they finished filming, there'll be like maybe another week or two, or maybe more, maybe another 3 weeks. I don't know. Probably not that long, but of where they just get those last bit of stuff that's filmed, because stuff is, like I said, sent to the editor daily. So they're putting all the pieces together. They're making this assembly cut, and they're getting this grand thing, you know, going down. And then they're taking notes. What are we missing? What could we use? And then they'll bring all that to Andy. So when Andy comes in, he goes, "All right, what do you think we're missing?" And then they'll go like this. And he goes, "Okay, well, you know what? I maybe shot this on this day, and maybe it's somewhere in here. Let's go look for that file." And then they have their assistant, the editor, someone go get that, you know, clip and send it to them. And then they go, "Okay, let's put that in here." And then they'll go through and they'll start, like I said, just fine tuning the, you know, the piano and making it work. And so, yeah, 8 to 10 weeks sounds about right for the most part. But sometimes things go a little longer. So I would say maybe 8 to 10 weeks from now that they're finished filming, they might need another 8 to 10 weeks to come up with a director's cut, maybe less, who knows. Maybe they don't need that much time to come with director's cut, because Andy does have other obligations. He's going to play Alfred in the new Batman movie, so who knows what that's going on. But he could probably easily work around his shoot with his editing. He could be like, "Hey, let's edit Monday through Friday, and then on Saturday and Sunday I'm going to go hang out with Batman," or whatever. They could easily come up with a schedule like that. That's a lot of work for a guy, you know, who's a little bit older, and he had an injury recently. But Andy Serkis has an amazing work ethic, and I saw him there on set directing stuff. And I saw someone saying like, "Oh, sometimes their assistant director will kind of come in and help them out." And I'm like, "Yeah, I never saw." And I mean, I'm sure there was one there, but I saw everything I saw there, the limited stuff I saw, and then some of the stuff that leaked. I saw Andy there behind the camera almost every time. So yeah, no, that guy has a work ethic like crazy, and so does Tom and everyone else. And I'm sure all these people that they're hiring to do post-production as well. So let me know what you think in the comments below of all this. Check out the links in the description box so you can learn more about this and see anything that I maybe missed or didn't cover, because obviously there's a ton of stuff. I could talk about this stuff for hours and still not cover all the process of filmmaking, but I wanted to give you a nice window into post-production, just like I did with pre-production back when we did that one. And again, I'll put a link to that video down in the description box below in case you missed that video. So yeah, again, let me know what you think. Thanks so much for watching the show. As always, like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff, and I'll see you all in the future. Peace.